this on? Is this on?
I'm abroad, if you can't tell. I'm abroad. Houston is not working with the microphone. So, I would just like to say two words of Mitt Romney. I'm fucking all right.
We have a strong culture here.
Can't keep up with this motherfucker. Okay? you know, the whole Clint Eastwood thing 3 weeks ago. Oh yeah, I mean, that's really gonna get old real fast, and yeah, it did. And now up into the 47%ers, you know, and Mittens just goes ahead and flips and flops and does this and does that. And if you saw him when he was governor of Massachusetts, it was good for, you know, like pro-choice and women make their own choices. Now if you get raped, you're going to have a baby in the papers to go to college, because that's what Mormon Jesus wants and Paul Ryan keeps just twisting my mind. I know that to do this, so I'm going to do this. But the fucker flip-flops so much. I think I saw him at Band of Loops the other night. Yes, he's a contortionist. You know, he could always walk like you know, the carnival bar. Okay, come in and see the freak show. See Mitt. Contort and now and do all these wonderful things with his body. It's nice if he would just stick to his own body instead of his dog Seamus's body. Now let me refresh your memory, because this is a couple Mitt stories ago, and a few years have gone by since then. Mitt and his family decide to take a trip. Years ago, and it was a family trip, and good one and family, five strapping young men who decided to do a mission in France and London instead of Kandahar and Islamabad, but it's okay. They pile into the car, and they're wonderful, wonderful. They have a dog, an Irish setter with the most creative name, Seamus. Now look, an Irish setter, I love dogs, I have all kinds of animals, and they are, but Irish setters are like the stupidest dogs in the world, okay? But you gotta love them, they're great pets, great pets. So Mitt wants to take the family on vacation, up goes Seamus, and what he's gonna do is he can't fit Seamus in the car, so he comes up with a brilliant idea, because I'm gonna put a crate on top of the car, I'll put a little windshield in front of it, and Seamus will come with us for a 10-hour road trip on top of a car. About halfway through, they pulled over because the diarrhea coming from Seamus was loading onto the windows of the car. Seamus is like, the one thing that Dad taught me was there is no way on God's green earth that Rodney's a cat person. Because I'm telling you right now, motherfucker, if he was going to put a cat in a cat carrier for a 10-hour trip, he would look like Gaga's outfit at the VMAs. He would be shredded meat. It would take a team of CSI experts days to put the pieces together. He is not a cat person. And I think we're all pretty good about that. I, for one, am a cat person. Yet I love dogs, too. I love dogs. We happen to have a couple of cats. And, you know, being a cat person is cool. You know, cats kind of do what they want. We haven't gone to the crazy cat level yet. I think the official level is 8, but I'm really not sure about it. It might be 8. So we're down at 2. Oh, but oh, this last winter we had 3. We had 3 kitties, and I'm not even really perfectly honest with you. This is a very emotional time for me to talk about Frank, or Frank. We like to name our cats after people. It really makes the neighbors go fucking crazy. So Frank, in this early winter, shuffled off his mortar coil and took his rightful place at the left hand of Satan. The most evil cat in the entire world was Frank. He had no redeeming values. We had him for 15 years. It was the Stockholm syndrome, okay? Maybe we can change it. Maybe we can change it. Frank's my regular. I'm my own cat. So when he adopted him, he was a stray. He didn't have a. He wasn't neutered yet, so while you guys can cross your legs right now and go like this, yes, so we might have his balls cut off. You can now cross your legs on that side. You're sitting next to somebody who wants to cut your balls off. And you're like, oh, man, that's, that didn't calm down. So, but our cats are indoor kitties. They're great indoor kitties. We don't have them around, but Frank would just go insane if you could look out one of the windows and see a neighborhood cat. I mean, it would just go crazy, absolutely crazy. He actually, one time in our kitchen, when the latch was broken on the storm door, and he was so mad, he pushed it open, squeezed out, and it was the first time I actually saw a cat fight go up at a hill. I mean, right ahead and charge after this cat, when we're fighting up at home, I can't believe this. I gotta get a camera. So anyway, he's a son of a bitch. Oh. And again, he belongs to Satan. How bad Frank is that we had other cats in the house. And one day, I'm coming home and I come over and see one of the cats, one of our cats was named Bundy. Named after Al, not Ted. All right? Do not take cats after serial killers who are showing us to, do that. So I think of us, I said, my Bundy started peeing on the rug. I'm like, you leave me on the rug for me, man. You're like 14, 15 years old. This can't be good. So we wrap Bundy up, say, let's go to the vet. Let's get you checked out. And we go to the vet, and we get him checked out. And the vet, great guys, wonderful place we go to, says, Bundy's in fine health, but I can't see anything wrong with him. I think it's time for Prozac. Prozac? For Bundy? And the vet goes, no, Frank. It's time for Frank on Prozac. Because obviously he is not letting Bundy go down to use the litter box. So for like 7 or 8 years, Frank was on Prozac, and people at Walgreens and always get a chuckle when I go in for the prescription. This would be Frank the Cat Clay. I got the Prozac, and then I got the chuckle when I'm pulled up and say the will for all. I don't shit now. So we tried a little Prozac, and that tried a little bit. But one of the things that our vet did too, I thought was so cool, and after a couple of years, I'm like, just knock the shit off, because we are just not going to. I just know you're doing it as a PR move, and it's okay. But because Frank was so evil, if we would go away on vacation or anything, we would board Frank, because I just not trust him to leave him alone for more than 48 hours. With the other two cats, unless he becomes like a raving fucking maniac. So we take Frank to the vets and board him, and they would say, when are you picking him up? And I thought, we got your credit card number, you're gonna come pick him up. So they come and pick up Frank after a few days, and they would give these report cards. I don't know anybody's pets has a kennel boarded or whatever, but it's real cute. Now, we had love, Frank. A plus, behavior. And we had 2 or 3 times, we keep getting this A plus, behavior. Frank's great. Haven't come out and visited again. I went one time to go pick up Frank and one of the vet technicians. This is a person who has gone to school to learn how to handle animals. Came up to me and said, "Will you please come take Frank out of the kennel? I'm scared to death of him." So I got him in chainmail and gloves. So I said, "Well, do me a favor. You know, don't waste the paper. We know he's a son of a bitch, all right? He doesn't have one redeeming fucking quality. He is just the worst cat ever." Has anybody ever spent 400 hours on a pizza? I have. It was a tasty pizza. It wasn't worth $400, but it was a tasty pizza. We were running errands one night. I was starting to get in a little late. Okay, we're going to just go. Let's order a pizza. Let's order a pizza. Because as you can tell, I try very hard to, you know, not work out at all. So, and pizza loves me. Pizza. Okay, fine. Let's go. Let's do this. So the change. My husband ordered the pizza. I went upstairs to change. And last words out of my mouth were, "Make sure Frank gets locked up in the basement, because he just loves to go down." I said, "Yeah, okay, fine." I go upstairs for a couple minutes. I come back downstairs, and on the dining room table is this nice 14-inch pepperoni pizza with paper plates and napkins. And I said, "What's wrong with this picture?" To my husband. And he goes, "Why? The pizza's here." I said, "Where the fuck is Frank?" So I said, "You didn't get out?" "I know he didn't get out. Frank could not got out. The pizza guy came, I gave the money, told him to keep the change. I know he didn't get out on my feet." I said, "This is not normal. There's a pizza on the table and there's no Frank. Let me do some recon." So I go to the front door, I open the front door, and I hear this massive cat fight. I mean, it is just the worst sound effects ever in the world. I'm like, "Oh shit, the fucker got out. This is gonna be way too much. Okay, we can do this." So there's nothing I can do. It's pitch dark out. Frank had the personality of a guy who, again, would treat his woman man, run around on her sneaking a cheap gin. Evening in Paris, carousing in the neighborhood, even though he didn't have any balls to do anything. But he acted like he did, you know. And they're smoking a cigarette, wearing a white beater, you know. So Frank and me, I'll leave the evidence. We can't break up this cat fight because, again, all of us here know Frank, knew of Frank. We all have the scars to prove trying to carouse Frank when he's a maniac. Frank decided after about an hour that he would sheepishly come home. And as always, he has flowers and a box of chocolates. And he's very remorseful. And he says, "I promise I really won't do this again. I'm here. Maybe I will go to therapy this time, hon. Okay? Let's go." So I'm looking over and he seems to look okay. The next morning, I get up, I look at Frank's jaw. His cheek is out to here. All right, so one of the cats got a good swipe into him. So, okay, here we go. You got an abscess. Off to the vet we go. Well, the abscess was so bad, not only could they cut him in the front, but then they had to go through the inside and then put him on antibiotics. He had to be in there overnight on an IV. And that's how I spent $400 on a fucking pizza. One last thing before I the great thing about, I'm a Philly girl, if you can't tell, but I'm my Philly hair. I love being in Rochester. I've been up here about 17 years, but again, Philly through and through, and I bleed Eagles green and Philly's red, and you know, my family knows what season it is when they have to run out of the house and make sure all the doors and windows are locked. Because if you think the motherfuckers are flying tonight, you should just come around football season and see how patient I am. But anyway, other than that, other than sports, I like to watch sports and things like that. What I really don't like, and I know it's got a great following, I know we're not too crazy about reality TV. Life is real enough. I don't want to see Nine Housewives and, and a Big Daddy or whatever it is. So I kind of stay, I like my fiction and my nonfiction, except when it comes to the Antiques Roadshow. The most wonderful show in the entire history of television. Now, I'm a collector of what you may say. Anything. I'm married to a collector of anything. This is not good. Couple of quarters, right, hoarders, yeah. Hoarders, I know we could audition for hoarders, but we don't have garbage, and so far we haven't found a cat carcass, so I think we're still okay. We're still okay with that, but I'm not talking about the future, okay? So, anyway, on to the Antiques Roadshow, I have learned a couple of very, very good life lessons, okay? First of all, the next time I move, I am moving next to a lady who's getting ready to die. And she's going to go into the nursing home, and she has to get rid of her stuff. And we'll help her move. And she'll say, thank you. Please take something for yourself. For yourself. Right. Can I say something? People dragging a table, And then they get the furniture appraised. I went, oh, okay, I thought the keynote covers were just so horrible. So they're like, well, this beautiful Art Deco table, since you know it's manufactured all across around here, it's got stickers on it, and even the artist assigned a lot of them of it, and it's worth $10,500. And we're like, she gave it to us because we could move and take anything that we wanted. Okay, so the next time I'm moving to an old lady's gonna die because I know I can clean up. It's gotta be better than buying scratch-offs. It's gotta be better than scratch-offs. The second thing I learned from the Antiques Roadshow is that I am the only motherfucker in history that does not own a piece of Tiffany. Every Antiques Roadshow has somebody, a schwab, who walks in with a piece of Tiffany. It's a lamp, it's a bottle, it's this or that. It's most comfortable Tiffany. It's worth $8 million, whatever. And I'm telling you this, I want a piece of Tiffany before I die. I don't care if it's Lord Comfort Tiffany's scrotum. And speaking of scrotums, Mitt Romney, good night.